Majordomo Minor is my third novel, and it tells of Lucy Minor, who is, in the beginning of the book, we see that he's a young man who has very little history and nothing ahead of him, very little to look forward to, and he leaves his home, the small village where he lives, and he's very unhappy, and he finds a job in a remote castle. And he arrives at the castle to find that there's all sorts of mystery and intrigue taking place in the castle. Some of it is sort of lighthearted and fun, and some of it is more acutely dangerous. But in the course of the novel, he sort of finds himself, and he falls in love, and becomes something closer to a man than at the beginning of the book. I keep coming back to characters who do and say ugly things, and I find something humorous about it, but there's also real drama there somehow. My approach to humor is always as a tool to share ugly information or bad news. You know, it's like if you're going to tell somebody something bad, it's always best to lead with a joke. And I find people relax. And if you can charm a reader, I find you can get away with so much more than if you're sort of approaching them from a higher point and looking down. So I like to think of the reader as being on the same level as me. And I want to entertain the reader, and so it's a good way to do that. And then to set them at ease with humor is also just, you know, they can relax, and then you can throw things at them that maybe they didn't expect or didn't see coming. And they're more likely to accept anything that you come up with if they're laughing. I think you think of a lot of actors, too. They like to have a prop, something to sort of busy themselves with. And I like the idea of this, essentially a child. Lucy's like a boy, basically, in the beginning of the book. But he wants to be a man. So what do men do? Men smoke pipes. So he just thought that that would make him sort of blend in and that people would accept him as a full-grown man. But he never figures out how to use it properly. It makes him choke and gag, and he's constantly having the pipes stolen by an area pickpocket. And I'm reminded of the scene in The Sisters Brothers with Eli's sisters, and he discovers his toothbrush. And he's just like really excited about the idea of brushing his teeth for the first time in 40 years. There's something about these props that we use in our life that I find comedic and silly, and so I keep returning to them. So yeah, French Exit is my fourth book, and it takes place, in the beginning it's in Manhattan, in the Upper East Side of New York City, and then the rest of it takes place in Paris, France. And it's the story of the Price family. Frances Price is the mother slash wife, and she's in her middle to late 60s, and she in her youth had been a great wit and beauty, someone, I suppose, like a Jackie Onassis or somebody like this. And at the point that we see her in this, in the beginning of the book, she's always been very wealthy and her money's all gone, we discover in the beginning of the book. So she and her adult son, Malcolm, who is in his 30s and has never lived on his own, he's very close with his mother in a way that's probably unhealthy and bizarre, they move to Paris, which is a city they know and love, to their money's gone, and they return to Paris just to sort of devolve together, to fall apart together. And it's called a tragedy of manners, we're calling it, because it adheres to all the rules of the traditional British comedy of manners, and yet there's a tragedy that takes place towards the end of the book, so that's where that phrase came from. The third character in the book is the father slash husband, whose name is Frank Price, and he'd been in an immoral litigator. He's a terrible man who's amassed a great fortune, and then he dies before the book has begun. He dies, but his spirit lives on in the body of a cat, and so the cat comes with Malcolm and Frances to Paris. This is a book that I'm actually rereading. I bought this maybe 10 years ago in Seattle, Washington, and it's called Nest of Ninnies, and it's a book that was written by two poets who are now deceased, John Ashbery and James Schuyler. And their work independently is just really wonderful, both geniuses, basically. And they, as an exercise, and then just for fun, they wrote a novel together. And this is a book that is in the same realm as Ivy Compton Burnett books or Jane Bowles. It's a couple of extended upper middle class families in upstate New York. And they constantly meet and have dinners and speak, and it's basically a novel told in dialogue. And there's no plot to speak of, very little happens. They travel around a bit, one of them opens a restaurant, but essentially the characters are revealed through the dialogue, and it's just, it's extremely silly. and yet at the same time, there's something very moving and profound about the whole thing. It says a lot about how families behave and how men and women interact romantically and socially. If you're looking for a plot-heavy book where, you know, a lot of things happen, then this will disappoint you. But if you enjoy studying the idiosyncrasies of humans and human nature and our means of communication, then it's a good place for you to start.